Welcome to part four of restoring this 125-year-old, 100-pound drop hammer. We've got ourselves a little bit of an issue. I was tapping around and checking the integrity of this cast iron, and turns out we got ourselves a little bit of a problem here. Nothing that a little bit of welding rod can't fix, but obviously at some point the ram or a piece that the ram was striking must have flown off and dented this pretty bad. This chunk is just sitting in here. So before we get to painting, I'm going to go ahead and grind this clean, weld it up, and get this looking like new. And additionally, while I'm doing that one, I'm going to tackle this one as well. We see we've got a pretty good chunk here and a pretty good chunk there. Once again, nothing that a little bit of welding rod can't take care of. So let's get to it. A lot of passes. We got both these sides built up pretty good. Profile's looking nice. Should grind down pretty smooth. So we're gonna get these ground down and then we are ready for painting. So for painting everything today, I'm gonna be using this Rust-Oleum high performance enamel. A nice dark machine gray. This is my favorite stuff. Real tough and works great for just about anything. So it was mentioned several times in the comment section by a variety of different people, these marks on the head of the bolt were from a chisel used to tighten the bolt up. This is bolt number 4, and I decided to leave it like that just so I could tell that story and so it can have a little bit of character. But it makes sense, because if you're in a real tight spot and you can't quite get a socket or a wrench in, you can take a chisel and start on one of these sides and hammer away, and that'll tighten it down and set it. So just kind of a neat little historical fact about this bolt. So here we've got everything all put together. Basically just slid all these pieces. Nothing's, you know, really tied down per se. This is just sort of to get it all fit up and figure out how we're gonna be mounting this thing. So this originally came with these brackets. And these are obviously wall-mounted brackets. So we started looking around for options and came up with this wall. What we're gonna have to do here, after a little bit of discussion, we figured brace it with some 2x6s on either one of these beams here, and then run a 2x6 across at the top and at the bottom of the brackets. got the hammer put in place where it's going to be. Went ahead, put some studs in the tops of these posts to secure these brackets. These brackets are going to mount on top of the hammer to the wall and then to this beam above. So we've done a fair amount of figuring and rearranging and probably taking these beams down and put them back up a couple dozen times. Basically, here's the orientation we figured. I'm gonna shift this tower into that next set of holes and try and fit everything to within this 4 foot section. So that means we're gonna have to cut the shaft in order for the gearbox and gear reducer to be on this side. So I've got the shaft all stripped down except for this last hub. So we got to pull that off, take this down, take some measurements, compare them against the pipe, make sure everything lines up right, and then we'll cut this down to size so it can fit within there and go from there. So I got a little bit creative here and made up this cardboard template to simulate that gear reducer gearbox. And we can see, got ourselves about 3/4 of an inch worth of clearance. So it should be a pretty tight fit, but I think it'll just barely work. So here we are the next day, got everything all taken down. We're getting ready for final assembly. Just have to clean up these holes a little bit. They look to be a 3/4 ten. I checked it with the pitch gauge and everything. So I'm just tapping that out with a 3/4 ten tap. It just got a little rusty and a little bit gummed up, but nothing that we can't fix. So I'm gonna get these cleaned up and then we'll be able to bolt directly to the top of here, to the frame over there, and then to a 2x6 running across here. Well, welcome to the attic of the shop. We're up close and pretty personal here. Don't have a whole lot of space to work with, so this thing is gonna be coming up one piece at a time, and it's kinda gonna have to get put together very carefully. Very close quarters, as I mentioned, and not a whole lot of room for error, so hopefully everything's gonna go okay. Thank you. So we've got just about a quarter inch of clearance between the outer rim of this drum and the roof. Whew. So here we've got this gear reducer all set up and tucked in right here in the roof. Got about a couple inches of clearance. Plenty of space to spare. So I went ahead and built a little loft up here. But basically all we're gonna be doing is getting all these nuts and bolts tightened down. Getting ready to get this thing running. So here we've got our belt coming down off the top of that drum. In order to interface to the ram and to the handle, I've taken some old pieces of flat belt, drilled a set of 5 holes. So I'll fold this over a ram just like this, and then it'll interface the top belt with an 1/8 inch pin. So here we've got this whole arrangement all set and ready to go. Got the same deal for our improvised handle here. And up top, got a 1.5 horsepower Dayton motor. And actually, this turnbuckle worked out great as a belt tensioner. So what I did was just loosen that up a little bit first, set the motor, got it to where it was halfway tight, got it all bolted down, and then I was able to use that turnbuckle to tighten up this belt pretty nicely. So at this point, we're ready to go. We got oil and everything, and just need to flip the switch. So let's see what happens. So that obviously fired up a little fast there. Might have to put a smaller pulley. We've got that drum turning pretty good. I guess let's give it a try. So I'm putting about 20 pounds worth of force, and this thing raises up really easy, like insanely easy. Look at that. Well, that's just about all we got for today. I really have enjoyed this whole process. This thing has just been nuts. You know, it's been a huge exercise in welding and fabrication and just getting everything to line up right and work right. And it's the largest restoration I've done, and I'm very proud of it. I hope you enjoyed watching the series, and I hope you learned a little something about these sort of hammers. Any questions, comments, or concerns can be left in the comment section down below. Check us out online, ironwolfindustrial.com, at ironwolfindustrial on Instagram and Facebook, and subscribe here on YouTube if you're not subscribed already. And other than that, we'll be making some dives and testing this out in part 5. So stay tuned. Thanks for watching. Work hard. Stay humble.
Mm-hmm.